Good morning, church. Yes, praise God. Thank you, Ms. Vicki. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Emmanuel Baptist Church. My name is Pastor Gino Mignone, and I have the honor and the privilege of leading the worship and praise this morning. My wife, Cheryl, and I are thrilled to be here, and I don't want to talk about myself. If you want to learn about me, there's a little insert in the bulletin. I encourage you just to look at that. And if you have any questions or whatever, I'll be glad to talk to you after the service is over. I especially want to welcome those who may be guests or visitors to our church for the first time. We are very glad that you are here. And in the pews, there are the blue connect cards. These are very important. And we ask you, if you would, to please fill these out. We want to get to know you. We want to know who you are, and we're a very loving church, and it's important for us to get to know you. So if you would fill these cards out, if you're with us, or if you're not, if you have a prayer request or whatever, at the end of the service, if you would drop this off at the Welcome Center, and we have a nice little gift for you. Praise God. Now I'm going to ask if you would join me in prayer this morning as we begin our worship service. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this beautiful morning. Your word tells us, Lord, for this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. Lord, we ask that you bless our service this morning, Father. We pray that we sing a joyful note unto you. I also pray that your Holy Spirit would anoint our pastor this morning as he brings forth the word of God. Lord, we thank you and praise you for this church. We thank you and praise you for the opportunity to worship you in your house this morning. We ask all these things in the glorious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Please stand as we begin our worship service.
Have you been to Jesus for this cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His name? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Oh, are you washed in that blood? In that so cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white? As so are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest in comfort in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in that blood? In so plenty blood.
To Jesus.
We glorify thy name thy name in all the
above all names, a name that is called Emmanuel, God with us.
Jesus, name above all names, He's beautiful Savior, glorious Lord.
The word tells us that God, thou art worthy. And the choir would like to worship this morning with you in singing Thou Art Worthy and Agnus Dei.
thou hast created, and all things created, thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are created.
Good morning, everyone. Brother Gino, thank you. Awesome. Awesome worship this morning. Last week, I was driving down the street out here on 466. And all of a sudden, something really blessed my heart. There was somebody riding beside me in a little car, and guess what I saw? I saw the Emmanuel invitation driving down the road. And I'm like, who was that? I got to find out who that was. I mean, we just handed those out, and all of a sudden I see one, and we're both going down the road. People are probably saying, man, when we went by them, they were probably saying, look at that. Both them cars got Emmanuel marks on them. So I sped up to get next to the person, and I'm trying to see who it is, but they're... The windows are slightly tinted, and I don't want to get in a wreck. So I'm looking, who is that? And I missed it the first time, and they were going on up, and I'm like, I've got to find out who that was. So I speed up again, and I'm looking, and I see this person, and they're content, they're not looking at me, they're looking at the road, and they're driving like looking at that road. And I'm like, I know who that is. I know exactly who it is. It's Susanna. Susanna Finn. Absolutely. Absolutely. So today is your payday. I saw you over by Rolling Acres Road this week. Rolling Hills Road. Rolling Acres Road. Yep, you were headed over that way, and I was heading that way. So that was a huge blessing to see that. We have those outside. If anybody wants one, we've got them for you. We've got something else that could be a big blessing to you, and that's Emmanuel 101. That's getting ready to start. And it's a good way of you finding out. It's not pinning you into anything, but it's finding out about what the church believes in our relationship to God, and what is a Baptist, and all these types of things are looked at. So even if today's your first time here, I would invite you to get a hold of Pastor Jeff, and he can help you with that. We've got a sign-up sheet out there, and he'll talk to you about that. And I'm going to open us with a prayer, and then we're going to be going to Matthew 13. So if you have a Bible with you today, I'd invite you to open up your favorite Bible to Matthew 13, and let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we're very thankful for every soul that's come in the building this morning. It's a blessing, Lord, to look out and see so many people that are so devoted to you, and also those that are here for the first time today. It's just a blessing to see everyone here. Father, we want to continue to lift you up, as Brother Gino has led us. We want to continue to lift you up and to magnify you. So, Lord, as we go into your word, I pray that you'll touch hearts today. I pray that you'll change lives today. I pray that you'll help us all become fully devoted followers of Christ. And I ask this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. So Matthew 13, I'm going to start reading in verse 44. It says, "The kingdom of heaven is like treasure buried in a field that a man found and reburied. Then in his joy he goes and sells everything he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. When he found one priceless pearl, he went and sold everything he had and bought it." Now, those are two very basic parables. They're very short, but they're also very powerful. We're going to look at them in pretty good depth. The first point that I want you to notice is this: spiritual treasure is always hidden. It's always hidden. It's in an unexpected place. It's always somewhere where you're not quite expecting it to be there, and then all of a sudden, boom, there it is. So this guy's working out in a field, and all of a sudden, there it is. He finds it. It's a total shock, and it's a complete accident. He doesn't expect this. Now, there's also a merchant that's looking for fine pearls, but he finds one that's of exceedingly great value. In both parables that we read, this great treasure comes upon them suddenly, and it unexpectedly appears right there where they're at. The second principle, when you find this spiritual treasure, is that you'll have to have it. You've got to get your hands on it. You know, because every part of your life can be revolutionized by this. So that's the second. Spiritual treasure never improves you. It completely remakes you. Now, I want you to notice that there's a lot of difference between these two people. They're very different. In one case, the treasure is found completely by accident. This person is sort of digging around in the field, and next thing you know, he scratches something, and suddenly, bam, there it is. On the other hand, the merchant is out, and he's actually looking. He's kind of looking and seeing what he can see. In one case, we probably have a normal man, a working man, somebody that is a common man, and he's just doing about what he kind of typically does. But pearl merchants are very different than that. Pearl merchants are people that would have had incredible wealth. They're trading in something that's very valuable. So they have incredible wealth. In the first case, we see this person go to buy the entire field. And the owner of the field has no idea of the value that's in the field. In the second case, the pearl merchant knows the value of what he's seeing, and he has to sell everything in order to buy this pearl that the seller has that's very valuable. And the seller knows how valuable it is. One knows, one does not know. Let's really hone in on this, and particularly the differences at first between these two people. One is rich and one is common, probably poor. One is deliberate and one finds it by accident. One has a seller who doesn't know what's going on, and the other has a seller that knows exactly what's going on. In other words, everything is different about these two guys. But when the spiritual treasure comes to both of them, everything completely changes. We know they're changed because of selling everything. They sell everything both times. They sell everything. One sold all he had to get a field, and everything is changed in their lives. There's no halfway when it comes to spiritual treasure. Spiritual treasure will never just change your life just a little bit. The spiritual treasure that Jesus is talking about will not change your life just a little bit. It won't just improve you. It's not a self-help. So the two principles are: spiritual treasure is never found where you expect it, and secondly, it will completely change your life. So spiritual treasure is never found where you expect it. Let me speak to that for a moment. The first principle is the pearl and the treasure are hidden and then found. But let's look at the first parable, because I really want you to see this very clear. Let's just ask a question about the situation. First of all, the man finds the treasure hidden in a field. This is Matthew 13:44, to remind you. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure buried in a field. There were no banks back then. When you had something that was of value, you dug a hole. Maybe you've heard even talk about grandparents burying mason jars in their yard or things like that. Well, if someone passed away and somebody didn't know, that treasure would be left there untouched, maybe never to be found. There's a possibility that it would never be found. So people here, this is no surprise in the Bible, people hid things of value. Because of that, there was a Jewish law that said, more or less, it said, finders keepers. Finders keepers. But the Jews at that time were also under Roman occupation. So the Roman law was ambiguous. And if the person were to take it, even though the Jewish law said that you get to keep what you found, they were afraid that maybe if they went to the Roman government, that the Romans may find that it's not exactly your right. So he decides he's going to go off and he's just going to buy the field. I'll sell everything I have to buy that field to get what I just found there. God's words tells us over and over again that Jesus always hides the treasure in the ordinary. This is really good. I really like this. And you're going to see, Jesus hides the treasure in the ordinary. You're never going to find it unless you penetrate down. You'll never find the treasure unless you penetrate down. Now, that's different than the world, because the world always looks at things on surface level. That's what the world's concerned about, just surface level. The world looks at the externals and the superficials. That's what they concentrate on. The world looks at value by looking at external things and superficial things. The world's superficial and external ways of judging things are so, so wrong. It's one of the biggest faults of the world. Not knowing the true value of something and just judging it on a face appearance. God's different than that. God isn't like that. He has a tendency to choose people just like you and just like me and just like them to do things that are spectacular. And Jesus buries his spiritual treasure in an ordinary message. The treasure that he has for humanity is buried right in an ordinary message. So let's stop for just a moment. And I put that on your handouts today. What is the gospel? What is the gospel? Listen to the gospel. The gospel message is Jesus Christ died on a cross for your sins, so that if you will believe in him, God accepts you by his grace. The gospel message is good news to everyone that finds it. This is what A.W. Tozer says. He says, we must constantly keep in mind that the gospel is not good news only, but a judgment as well upon everyone who that hears it. The message of the cross is good news indeed for the penitent, the one that sells everything and grabs hold of it. But to those who obey not the gospel, it carries an overtone of warning. This is the gospel message given to us in the New Testament and in the four Gospels. This is what Augustine says. He says, if you believe what you like in the Gospels and you reject what you don't like, it's not the gospel you believe, but yourself. And the gospel message is hidden from so many today. It's an ordinary message. Some may say, listen to that. Listen to that. And then say, what else? What else? Is that it? Is that the gospel? Is that the message? Is that the secret to life, what the pastor's just now saying? It's buried in an ordinary message. Is that the secret of the universe the pastor's up there talking about? Yes, it is. That's it. That's it. It's buried in the ordinary. Sell everything and buy it. Get your hands on it. Sell everything and get a hold of that. You grab that. That is of utmost importance. Sell everything and get that message. If you're here and you're not sure you're a Christian or that you even believe in Christianity, one thing is you've really got to get over the simplicity of the gospel. It's simple. It's so simple even a child can understand it. Jesus Christ died on a cross for your sins. If you believe him, you will be forgiven, and that's by grace. He just forgives you because you ask. It's like a field. It's like the field that you just walk by every day, and you don't pay any attention to it. And when you hear Jesus died on a cross for my sins, so God can accept me through grace if I'll only believe in him, do you realize that's really the answer to all your problems? That is your answer. That is the answer to every problem. That's the problem to what's going on in the Middle East and in China and in America. It's the answer to the problem in what's going on in Oxford and the villages and Orlando. It's the answer to the problem everywhere. Just scrape the surface, and it's sitting right there. The treasure. The treasure. Jesus is the true solution to all of your problems and all of the world's problems. The gospel from Christ is exactly what you need. This is the way to get through this cruel life, by trusting Jesus Christ. If you think for a moment that, boy, he sure is overblowing that, I'm telling you to dig into it, because that is it. That's it. Don't walk by the pearl. That's the pearl. Don't just walk by it. Your treasure is just below the surface in that field, in those simple words. Please begin to realize Jesus Christ buries his treasure under a field of ordinary. Don't be a fool. Don't be a fool and just walk on by. Jesus Christ also buries his treasure in himself. He came as an ordinary baby. Everything about Jesus completely resists the world's obsession with surface level image and glitter and lights. Don't be blinded by the temporary standards of the world and what they lift up, because what they lift up is totally different than what God lifts up. You should be after the treasure in the ordinary field. You should be after becoming the person of incredible quality and beauty on the inside. It's all about the inside. It's not about the outside. You should be a person of enormous peace and a person of enormous courage through Jesus Christ, through him and his message. That's really what lasts. Spiritual treasure is always buried in a field of ordinary. You've got to get over the world's false standards, or you're never going to grab it. And number two, spiritual treasure changes your life utterly and totally. It changes your life. Spiritual treasure is so much different than earthly treasure. In our last few moments of this sermon, I want to give you an example of human wisdom. What humans think is wise and smart. Are you ready? Are you ready? Human wisdom. So this is what Tappan Adney said. Whichever trail you took, you wish you'd took the other. And this is what Martha said when she saw, there really ain't no choice. One's hell and the other's damnation. We are talking about the world's way. Do you remember? The world sees value by looking at externals and superficials. The Stampeders heard about gold, and off they went. They came from all down California, all over the place, and made their way up, which was tough in and of itself. I'm starting the story in Alaska. But imagine back in the day, in the 1800s, getting to Alaska from San Francisco. They heard about the gold, and off they went. It was a hard, expensive journey just to get to the real journey. In Alaska's little towns, homesteads faced tens of thousands of people making their way, trying to get up to find some gold. And when they showed up there in the Skagway area, one of the things that was mandatory was to go out on the trail there, you had to have a year's worth of provisions. And then they had to try to carry that year's worth of provisions any way that they could. That was the starting point right there. That's the starting point. Now, if you saw that during the spring, you would see that's not no regular snow hill there where you go skiing. That's full of boulders. So they faced their greatest hardships on the Chilkoot Trail and the White Pass Trail out of Skagway. There were murders, there were suicides, there was disease, there was malnutrition, and there was deaths from hypothermia. There were avalanches, and there was heartbreak everywhere. Pack animals could not be used very well because of the massive boulders that were on the pass. At first, the Stampeders had to carry everything on their backs. And the White Pass Trail was known as the animal killer. As anxious prospectors overloaded and beat their animals to try to get them to move and get up everything that you're seeing there. No roads, no trails. Many of their bones still lie at the bottom of Dead Gulch Valley. You see them today. During the first year of the Yukon Gold Rush, an estimated 20,000 worldly wise gold seekers spent an average of 3 months packing their outfits up the trails and over the passes to the lakes. The distance was only 35 miles, but each individual trudged hundreds of miles back and forth, trying to move their year's supply of gear from hiding place to hiding place. Once the prospectors had hauled everything to the lakes, then they had to build a boat or buy a boat. And then they had to float 560 miles downriver. And that's where the limitless gold nuggets could be found. By midsummer of 1898, there were 18,000 people in Dawson, with more than 5,000 people mining. Of the estimated 30 to 40,000 people who reached Dawson City during the gold rush, only half of them ever even became prospectors. Of these, no more than 4,000 struck gold. And only a few hundred out of the 40,000 became rich. That's one half of 1%. Roughly one half of 1%. The cost on the animals, the cost on the marriages, the death of the people seeking this worldly riches was crazy. And this is what Alfred McMichael said in 1898. He said, "Men on arrival here have suddenly found out the unlimited opportunities for getting suddenly rich will not be reached no matter how great their capacity for enduring work and hardships. They ain't gonna get rich is what he's saying. It's like banking everything today on somebody being in the major leagues or, you know, yeah, there's a small number. But look at the people that bit it, hook, line, and sinker. And look at the cost involved with that. Oh my goodness. Has your life ever been consumed with following the next fad or the next shiny thing? The glitz, what the world lifts high? Are you stampeding through your life on surface level? Never digging just below the surface for the simple truth of Jesus and his treasure. I ask you today to consider eternity. I ask you today to consider the ordinary message of Christ. Consider it. And I ask you today that if you don't have it, to sell everything and grab it. Grab it. His treasure will endure all the way to eternity. You should be after his treasure. Right in an ordinary field. You should be after becoming a person of incredible quality and love. You should be chasing after becoming a person of beauty on the inside, not the outside. It's what's on the inside that matters. A person of enormous peace and enormous courage. That's what you should want to be. Grab the treasure, the ordinary treasure, that's just under the surface level. That's really what lasts. If you're not a follower of Christ, if you're not a follower of Christ today, sell everything. I ask you to come forward now. We're going to have a time of invitation. This is a time when you can commit your life to Jesus. It's a time where maybe you could even look at what it would take to be a member of Emmanuel. Or maybe there's something going on in your life where you would like someone to come around you and pray for you. Maybe you've had something happen and you need prayers of brothers and sisters. If that's you, I'd like to ask you to come forward for any of that. But friend, the most important thing is you've got to have the right treasure or you're going to end up on a Chilkoot trail with a dead animal. Get your hand on that real treasure, brother.
Change my heart, O God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, O God. May I be like you.
Anyone.
Change my heart,
any concern.
O God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, O God. May I be like you. You are the potter. I am the clay. Mold me and make me.
Time is passing.
This is what I pray.
come. Make it ever true. Change my heart, O God. May I be like you.
Thank you, Pastor. At this time, Brother Ken Cummings is coming to lead us in prayer.
Let's pray. Father, we just come to you today. We've heard the story this morning. Lord, yes, we just have to give up everything to follow you. And Lord, it's our time now where we can give up a little bit of what God has given us in our tithes and our offerings and that. So Lord, just reach out here that you bless, continue to bless this church. And we thank you for all of this. And we pray it and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Vicki, I want to close out today with prayer, but I want to call your attention to the flowers down front. These are placed here by the church in memory of Brother Jerry Montgomery. There was a private small gathering of people yesterday where they buried his ashes, and we wanted to call attention to that in his memory. So Miss Madeline was not feeling well this morning, so that she'll receive those flowers. Also, we wanted to Debbie, we want to be praying for you in the loss of your mom, Loretta Hennessy. Debbie McLaren and Tammy Pace are members of our church, and we are praying for them during this time. And as I'm talking about that, let me also remind you that the graveside service for Ann Spradling, which is Barbara Kernosh's sister and Kathy Craig's mother, will be this Friday at 11 o'clock at Forest Lawn Cemetery in Ocala. So thank you for being here today. Let's pray. If you would stand with me, and we'll have prayer, and then Brother Gina will lead us in our closing hymn. Would you stand with me? Father, we thank you for the gathering of your people here today. Father, thank you that we have had the privilege of gather here to worship you, to sing your praises, to study your word. Father, I thank you for your love for us and your presence in our midst, Father, today as we have worshiped you in spirit and in truth. Father, we love you. We pray that you'll dismiss us with your love and grace as we leave this church building to go out in this community to be the church. For we pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. Brother Gino?
Thank you, Pastor Jeff.
Please join us in our closing song this morning, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Great is Thy faithfulness, O God.
See you next Sunday. God bless you. Stay with me.
Thou changest not.